My heart leaps when I hear that music. Do you recognize that music? It's my old signature tune. Ah, those were happy days. Were you happy then?
Absolutely.
You'd never tell. The days when people had signature tunes were happy days because it felt as if we belonged. Now they just start, have to talk to the fat boy. There was a time you could have a signature tune like this and say how you felt. You'd say things like, I feel great this morning. Or else you'd say things like, I don't feel great this morning. And people would care because they knew it was your music, not somebody else's. It was your music, the music that belonged to you, music that you had picked. Anyway, did you have a nice Christmas?
Me?
Yes.
Yes, it was all right.
I thought it was an anticlimax because Jesus didn't come to visit me. Santa came, but I want them all. I don't like being kind of singled out to be snubbed like that. Did you get any nice presents?
Yes, some lovely socks.
how did you do in the hanky front? Listen, people are wondering whether we're here or not. So what I'll do is, to prove we're here, I shall pinch you. Okay?
Right.
Ah! You see?
That was sore. That was too sore.
Very hard to do through a wall.
Yes.
Anyway, let's get
I want to tell you something
before you
continue. I was listening to the radio about 2 weeks ago, a Saturday afternoon, and a good friend of yours was on Radio 2.
Whom was that?
Johnny Walker.
Johnny Walker.
Johnny Walker. And he was talking to Dwayne Eddy. Was his guest.
How interesting, yeah?
Yeah, but...
Was I mentioned?
Not at the part I heard, but Dwayne Eddy said to him, he says, Johnny, he says, you played my tune for years and years. He says, yes. He says, I played... I forget the name of Johnny Walker's tune, or the Dwayne Eddy tune that he played. I think it may have been Because They're Young.
Or 40 Miles of Bad Road.
No.
That's okay. That's all right.
That's 40 Miles of Bad Road.
Yes, I know.
Right? But anyway, Johnny Walker, just like you, Johnny Walker says a signature tune was great. He says, because you were ready and you knew. And he said to Dwayne Eddy, he says, Dwayne, I knew when you went into this particular business, it was for me, time for me to speak. And I was ready for it.
That's right.
And Dwayne Eddy says, well, why did you stop? And Johnny Walker says, he says, because some guy in a suit in the BBC decided we should all drop our sig tunes.
That's right.
And Johnny Walker was quite angry.
He was angry, and every reason to be angry, because he took away our identity. And I don't feel as if I'm a real person anymore because I have no signature. Look at me. Look at me.
No, but it eases you into the program,
look at me,
doesn't
turn it?
Up.
I want to get every.
Yes, go on!
The big country. Oh, I wish I could go back to my signature tune. The only thing wrong with it, though, it fades out almost like me. Happy Christmas!
It's great, isn't it?
I enjoyed that.
We have another year to look forward to.
Who knows, we mightn't have a year. Could be less. Could be gone tomorrow. I know you say you're ready to change, but I need to get it down on paper. It's in your face, you're ready to blame the first guy in line to catch the train. I'll say beating up on you. That's Eliza Doolittle, and that's a song called Rollerblades. Or is it called that at all? I don't know what it's called. I think it's called something like that. Do you know what this is called?
I think it's called Rollerblades.
It is called Rollerblades. Yeah. It's that funny writing on the front.
Yeah.
You know what you can't read?
But it's a nice song.
Psychedelic people started that in the 60s. They get posters that you couldn't read, and you have to stick your face up beside them saying, what's that? Is that a dance? And what? Is that the night? Tomorrow night? What? What? You couldn't make out the psychedelic things. Now, what are we doing today?
Looking back.
Looking back. You see, this is a great chance for you to hear what I do on a Friday. Because I know you don't listen.
I know.
What we're doing is we're trying
to... go to the credit union.
I know. It's important that you keep your book maintained.
Yes.
Well, what I do on a Friday is, when you're not here, I enjoy myself, basically. Not because you're not here, but because I enjoy myself because I like music. So what I try and do on a Friday, I try and bring in people who are very talented. And there's no reason why you shouldn't be there, but you're just not required. People come... Now, are you hurt by that?
Yeah.
Well, you see, what would you do? You'd be redundant on a Friday because I just go in and talk to people about music and you don't like their music, so you don't want to talk to them at all.
I could bring them to the studio for you.
Now we have people to do that.
And make them tea.
People in work experience do that. No.
I also could bring my trombone.
I think that possibly that would not be what I want. You see, you have to consider what we all want. So we had various people going through the doors and we're not going to, play wee bits from everybody. We're going to play some of the best bits, which I think were the best. And one of the best, I think, was Christy Moore. Do you like Christy Moore?
Yes.
Christy Moore is my favourite. Christy Moore is so talented. And you know the thing that scares me about Christy Moore? He listens to what you say.
Yeah.
You know, I just sit here and talk. I don't care what I say. He picks up on things. If I said to him, I was doing such a study, he'd ask me about it. He'd say, well, what did you do? You know, he's very interested in what
he's a good listener.
Good listener. But see, I don't know what that's like.
No.
I don't never listen to anybody. Mm-hmm. So when I meet somebody who's a good listener, it scares me.
What?
It scares me when I hear somebody who's a good listener because I feel as if they're listening to what I say. And, you know, it scares me and I stop talking when I realise they're listening to me. I know you don't listen to a word I say, so I can talk to you all day. You don't hear anything. But Christy Moore listens. He's a great talent and he's got a wonderful... Do you know what he has?
Who?
Christy Moore. Do you know what he has? He has a good heart. Now, Fergal Sharkey once said that. It's hard to find. But I found one in Christy. So we'll let him talk, let him sing. Okay? Here we go. Christy Moore.
It's a pleasure to be here.
You've got a new album out now called Listen, which I think is wonderful.
Thank you.
It's like having a baby, we were talking earlier, isn't it? Conception is swift. Conception is swift. And then you have to kind of, the gestation period, the labour. And then you go into hospital to have the baby. And that's you in the studio. And then when it's ready, the baby comes out. And then you have to hawk it about. And say, oh, what's he like? Is he like his daddy or what? Something like the last one. There we go. So how did you feel about the album in general? And what was the story behind it?
The album started a couple of years ago, but there was two different starts made at it that were didn't amount to anything. The first album, we had this idea and we started it off and it just wasn't going anywhere. And then we started off another one and it wasn't going anywhere. And then about 12 months ago, we started this, Declan and I, down in Cork. And straight away, we got into a groove. And it just all started to come together.
People would be interested in that, you know, because people probably don't realise that, you know, that sometimes when you start an album, you ditch it. You know, because, I mean, what do you do? Do you go into the studio, try a few things, and then you say, no, that's not working. And then you go away and say, forget about it, maybe do something later. Is that the way it actually works?
Well, we started off about 2 years ago. I had this idea to do an album of songs from across the water. Songs that I'd gleaned over the years in England and Scotland and Wales. And I had a good bunch of songs, but it just didn't hang together. And we just dropped it and started again. And the next idea didn't hang together either. It was to do kind of songs on my own that never made it onto...
No, but you see, you're an excellent writer. And, you know, do you have confidence in your own songs? I think they're great.
Well, thank you. I wouldn't have great confidence.
I don't think you have, no.
In them now, you know. But I wouldn't be too prolific either. I don't write that many songs, and particularly in the last few years. I mean, gems come your way, and I tend to... I suppose if a beautiful song comes my way, it makes me a bit lazy. Mm. I get this beautiful song in the post or from another writer, and I don't have the hassle of writing. I just have to learn it and sing it.
Now, I know you don't like a compliment, but, you know, you're very much a musician, but I always look at you as a wordsmith. more than anything else. And I think you should write more. And not just songs, but I think you should write that book that you should be writing. I know the last one you had out was about, what was it called, One Voice, about the songs. Yeah. And that was basically about the songs that meant something to you. But I notice on your website you go into all kinds of detail about your life, about particularly about Newbridge and about your childhood and stuff like that. You're a born writer. It's time you wrote that book. No, wait until you retire. And then you'll have something to do.
Well, with the retiring thing, I went to see Tina Turner 2 weeks ago, and all thoughts of retiring are just... I mean, I saw Leonard Cohen last year, and I have another 10 years to go before I catch up on him. And Tanya, I mean, Tina was at 70. The shapes and the energy in her singing, she really is inspirational.
The last time I saw her was in Belfast in the King's Hall, and that must be about 10 years ago, maybe more. And she was packing it in then. And then when I heard she was coming back, people would say to you, you know, what are you thinking? I said, don't miss it. Don't, because you knew. Tina Turner doesn't lie down. When she goes on stage, you just go, whoa, look at that.
Yeah.
Here, listen, stop talking.
But also the band were having such fun. And it's so important when people up on stage are having great crack. The chances are the audience are as well.
And you can sense that, you know, because you can always tell when people can feel the emotions. And when a band's really enjoying themselves. Do you know the last time I saw that? And I suppose enjoying themselves is a different thing. I people are fed up with me talking about this. But a couple of weeks ago, I went to see Van Morrison in the Albert Hall doing Astral Weeks for the first time. I have never heard anything like that in my life. He was enjoying himself. And do you know what it's like for Van to enjoy himself? Yeah. That's a very rare thing.
Sure
and
is.
He was jumping out of his skin. But the band were terrified of him. But the fact that he was enjoying himself meant that they actually went out of their minds, like, because they'd probably never seen him enjoying himself before. And he was kind of conducting them like this, you know, he was going mad.
It must have been marvellous.
It was wonderful. Anyway, listen, we're talking far too much. People want to hear you singing. Do you want to do something off the album, or do whatever you like?
I'd love to.
What are you going to do, and what is it?
I'll start off with Listen.
Okay. Well, tell me about the song itself.
Hank Waddell is a fellow from Cork who sings around the pubs in Cork.
Yeah.
And I heard him sing this song about 18 months ago, and just everything went very quiet for me when I heard it. It just went straight to my heart. It's a lovely thing.
Okay.
Listen to the whisper of moonlight on the water. Close your eyes and listen. Listen to the singing of a feather on the breeze. Close your eyes and listen. Listen. Listen to the harmony of heartbeats in unison. Close your eyes and listen. And listen to the rhythm of souls dancing round the stars. Close your eyes and listen. 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 Listen to the ringing of the distant bells calling. Listen to the flutter of an angel's wings on high. Listen to the rapping and the clapping and the buzzing. Listen to the snow fall gently on the mining town. Close your eyes and listen. Close your eyes and listen. Listen to the whisper of moonlight on the water. Listen to the singing of a feather on the breeze. Listen to the prayers of children to their blessed mother. Listen to the pleading of the faithful to their father. Listen.
Oh, that's lovely. I can see why you like that song. It's fantastic, isn't it?
It's just a lovely series of lines.
It's just beautiful, yeah.
It's very hard to learn because there's no narrative. So I actually have to write down one word from every line. no matter how often I sing it.
Is that how you remember a wee kind of a wee bullet point for the line? Just maybe a wee piece of the line every now and again. You don't write down the whole song.
No, just one word from each line. It's a divil to learn this song.
What is your favourite song in this album? If indeed it's not that one.
Oh God, it's a hard one. Well, I suppose it's a song called Gerta Toggart. It's a song written by John Spillane, and he wrote it about his mother's home place. And I heard him sing it, and then I went with him to his mother's home place, and we walked the land, we walked the hill, and we walked all the fields that are mentioned in the song. And it was just a beautiful, beautiful day. And then we went into his grandaunt house, Mary McCarthy, and she took down the fiddle, which she hadn't been playing for years, and she played beautifully.
Were your parents, are your parents gone now?
Both, they both passed.
Were they musical?
My mother was very, very musical. My father could sing the song of the day. That's as the garden where the praties grow, I've got a lovely bunch of coconuts, those kind of songs. But my mother was a serious kind of a singer.
Yeah. My father used to play the piano on Christmas Day only.
Really?
Never played it any other time. And I always regret not ever asked him. I never asked him why.
And what did he play?
He played a bit of classical. He did. But he never played. I always got the feeling that he probably had been disillusioned somewhere along the line. And every Christmas Day he used to make a big thing and he'd pull out the piano stool and he'd play. And you know that time you just took it for granted. But you never say, why do you not play any other time? You know, he didn't ask your parents stuff, you know.
Because I'd say looking back on it now, it's probably a magical memory.
Actually, yeah. Were your parents a wee bit like that? Did your father burst into song every now and again, no?
No, my mother never stopped. My mother sang in the church, and she, as a young girl, she sang in musicals. Uh-huh. She sang traditional songs. She sang light opera. She sang the songs of the Mass and all that, and she was a wonderful singer.
And did she encourage you, or did you get your love for music from her, or did it just come out of the blue?
My earliest thoughts of Mammy were of her singing, and right up to the time she passed, when I would have an album coming out or when I'd be working on songs, I would always go down and play them. And she would listen very carefully and she would always have really pertinent things to say. And she was a stickler for diction. I mean, I was well into my 40s and Mammy was still giving out to me about my diction. And of course, it's so important.
But your diction is special. I mean, every word is crisp.
Well, they are. I mean, the words are very special things.
I remember when my people are all from Donegal, and the thing that I always remember about them, and if anybody ever talks to me about them, I always remember they had this love of words. They used to roll them around in their mouths, you know, and they used to kind of, if they found a word like that you wouldn't normally use, they'd say, it's very decadent. You know, they'd say, decadent. You know, and a parabola. They loved it as if they'd been saying it for the first time. And I always bring that back to maybe perhaps, you know, people and their grandparents spoke Irish. So in some way, a new word, they liked the sound of it more than, you know, English people don't like that. Nothing wrong with English people, but they use words functionally. But Irish people just love the sound of them. Don't they really?
We relish
the sound of them. Mm. So I remember somebody saying to me one time, Scottish people spit out words, you know, but Irish people, they roll them around their mouths like ice cream.
Okay. Yeah, that's lovely. I've been listening to Seamus Heaney a lot lately because I got the box set, the 16 CDs of him reading his own poems. Well, and there's constant, beautiful sounding words coming out.
Yeah, indeed. I do a passable imitation of Seamus Heaney, but I won't do it now because people have slagged me about it. He kind of talks a little like this, you know.
He does.
Well, Christy, do you fancy doing that wee song you talked about, or would you like to do something else? That Gerta Toggart, or do you want to do something else?
I'd love to do Gerta Toggart.
Oh, yes, please. I said Gerta Hart.
Well, it is a hard one.
Well, let me get this right. Gerta Toggart.
Gerta Toggart.
Gerta Toggart.
Yeah. It may be the field of the priest. It may be from the time...
translation.
The Mass Rock. It may be in the place in penal times where people had to go secretly to celebrate their religion.
Okay.
But I'm not too sure about that.
All right, then. I'll take your word for it.
I sing the field, I sing the farm, I sing the house my mother was born in Gerta Toggart, Cullamon, a green jewel sown in a patchwork quilt of fields between the mountain and the river in this time now and in another, where I ran free with me brothers through the long meadow and the Canuck on Rua, the Fort Field, the Park na Cloche, the Newhouse Field, the Galan Field, the Clover Field, the Rushy Field, where the red fuchsia weeps in the hen's garden and the angels bleed over Bantry Bay. That's the first verse of it. Will I continue?
Yes. Why not?
I see the house, I see the yard, I see the stall, I see the stable, I see the haggard and the sandy field, I see the hill, I see the well, I sing the spring of well water, I sing the field of standing stones, the south ray grass, the north ray grass, the brake and the porky in the horn, where the red fuchsia weeps in the hen's garden, where God goes to sleep in the hills and the valleys, where the moon rises over the haggard, where peace descends on Gurta Toggart, and the angels bleed over Bantry Bay. Oh, saddle up the old grey mare, Tim Big Danny and Jackie Timmy are gonna ride across the mountain to Puck Fair. I see the house, I see the yard, I see the stall, I see the stable, I see the haggard and the sandy field, I see the hill, I see the well.
That's the very thing we were talking about, the words, the love of the language, the sound of them. That's all about the sound of words, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
What a great song that is. And, you know, I heard that, but when you're singing it live, it seems more different.
He captures something in that song. Like, that place is down in West Cork, and I come from Kildare in the middle of the country. And yet, when I sing that song, it's the pictures of the home place I see. I see the different fields that used to be there. I see the old haggard and the old milking parlour and the old well, and I remember drawing water from the well. So I think he's written a song that anyone who's connected to the land can live in that song.
Well, were you from a farm, basically, or was it Newbridge you were born? Well, in the town itself, was it?
I grew up in the town of Newbridge, but my granny Dowland lived 3 miles out the road, and I used to cycle out there during the week to get eggs, to get milk, to get butter.
Yeah.
And I'd cycle back into town with all this stuff tied to the handlebars of the bike.
Listen, it's your birthday today. You didn't tell me that. I had to find that out myself. And I know we're not going to take any calls today because people who ring up whenever you're on, they always say the same thing. Oh, you're great, you're great, you're great, you're great. And I know you get fed up with that. Not that you don't appreciate it, but it's all the same, it's all the same. So, but there's a gentleman on the line who wants to say hello to you. He's an old colleague of yours, a man who plays saxophone with Moving Hearts and did from the very beginning. Keith Donald. Good morning, Keith.
How you doing, Jerry? You well?
Yes, I am indeed. I've just informed Christy that it is his birthday. I think he knew.
Yeah.
he can hear you.
Yeah, okay. Christy, I've just one thing to say to you. Hang on there.
Oh, Keith.
He can't just play a tune, can he? Filthy jazzer.
There you go.
You're a darling man, Keith. I love you.
Thank you, Keith.
Thank you very, very much, Keith. That's beautiful.
All right. You're great.
Thank you very much, Keith.
All right, take care.
Okay.
Good luck, all.
Bye, bye. Well, you see, I've never heard Happy Birthday played like that before. You put that on record. Well, happy birthday. So, 50 today, then.
No, I was born on the 7th of May, 1945.
Don't be saying that. They'll be at home with their calculators.
And I was just thinking this morning that...
When I'm 64.
They were dancing on the streets of Europe on... It was VE Day. And all I was worried about was milk. Where's the next drop of milk coming from?
Well, sure, we're still the same today, if the truth be told. More messages coming in. Jerry, I know you said yesterday you don't like treating Christy Moore like a jukebox. Because people do tend to treat you like a jukebox. Because they've all got their favourite songs and they're always saying to you things. Oh, play Nancy Spain, play Nancy Spain. And it's very hard to say no, I know. I was wondering if you could possibly hint at Bee's Wing, a most beautiful and moving song. No. Or maybe you want to, I don't know. Please tell Christy there aren't too many boys that can pull off Shine On You Crazy Diamond. Now, that's Pink Floyd song, mm-hmm. Sid Barrett. Very unusual to find. Well, if you find Billy Fury on it, why not Sid Barrett? Did you particularly like that song, Shine On You Crazy Diamond?
It's a classical song.
Yeah.
I mean, the words are just so beautiful. And also, I think most people who will listen to that song carefully, it will be about people they knew in their time. And that's what I like about it. The song can just take on, it can wear different clothes.
That's right. And it's the type of song sometimes that you, for some reason, I've noticed this, I heard this a number of times, other people singing it as well, you tend not to listen to the words. I don't know why that is, maybe it's just me, but I only listen to the words when I heard your version.
Well, there's a very, very obvious reason for it.
Why?
There's on the Pink Floyd version, there's a 9-minute instrumental before the words come in.
Well, by the time it comes, you couldn't care less.
And I think that's why it probably... it isn't that well known outside the kind of people who are into that genre of music. And mm-hmm. It deserves to be known by everyone, because I think everyone can get something from that song.
OK. And you say in the sleeve notes that it feels like an old Shannon song.
It feels that way to me. It feels like an ancient song.
Shannos, I mean, for the benefit of people who don't realise, what would be your definition of a Shannos song?
Well, it's literally, it means the old style.
Yeah.
And it's people who sing in the old style of singing before there was accompaniment, or before people like Joe Heaney and Paddy Tunney and Len Graham and Joe Holmes, people who sang in the old style where the lyric was everything. That's the Shannos.
You and I are lucky enough to remember people in the country when they used to sing before they had TV. I'm nowhere near your age, but close enough. But I remember being down in Donegal and watching people just sitting in the corner. You'll sing a song, Paddy. Oh, no, not at all. You will. And it's good on. And then the cap comes off. Cap goes on the knee. And then away he goes, singing into the fire. You know, and I don't think that happens too much anymore. It probably does, but maybe it's a little forced. It doesn't happen naturally. Maybe it may happen with the best will in the world, but it's always a little forced. It's not natural. So I think, I assume that I'm right in saying that you saw that in its natural state when you were a young man.
Oh, very much so.
Yeah.
Yeah, where the song was a very important part of the evening.
Yeah.
And, I mean, now the world is so, so different now, but occasionally, when a song session breaks out unexpectedly, people can be blown away by it because they've never experienced it before.
That's right.
When I even see it with my younger members of my own family,
yeah,
they will be kind of a little bit apprehensive, or they'll be kind of maybe laughing a little bit at it. But once it starts, they just get totally enthralled.
But you see, it's something that just takes you over, and there's no explanation for it. It's just within you.
Yeah.
And if it's within you, you respond. Now, I don't know if you feel like doing that or not. We talked about Shane. Do you fancy doing something else?
Yeah.
Whatever you like.
I thought of a song this morning. As I walked in, the first man I met downstairs was Mickey Bradley.
Undertone.
And this song came to mind. And can I tell a little story about it?
Yeah, of course.
Because the late John Peel, his favourite song was always the Undertone song. And his second favourite song was this song. And his wife said, John Peel could not play this song without shedding a tear. It's a song about his home place. Mackenzie's soul lies above the ground in that pyramid near Maryland. EasyJet is hanging in the air, flying everybody everywhere. See the slave ship sailing into port. The blood of Africa's in every wharf. There's a ley line runs down Matthew Street, giving energy to all it meets. Hey, does this train stop? Does this train stop in Merseyside? Hey, does this train stop? Does this train stop in Merseyside? Alan Williams in the Marlborough Arms, he gives a story out to everyone. The famine boats are anchored in the bay, bringing in the poor and desperate. I can't believe what these children done. Guess there's a meanness in the soul of man. Yorkshire policemen stand with folded arms while people try to save their fellow fans. Hey, does this train stop? Does this train stop in Merseyside? Hey, does this train stop? Does this train stop on Merseyside?
Excellent. That's on your album as well. The album is called Listen, and it's out now. I'm just looking at some of the other tracks. Barrowland, that's a particularly favourite of yours. Barrowland, I was in Barrowland when I was 17. It's a wonderful place.
Oh, great.
Is it all gone now?
No, it's the very same as it was.
You're not serious.
It's identical.
I used to be frightened in there.
It's a but the
scary
vibe in the place.
It was an old dance hall in Glasgow, basically, and all the Irish show bands used to play there, and I'm sure all the folkies as well. You'd have been a folkie then. And you still are.
Thankfully.
No, but I used to be frightened in there because everybody in Glasgow at that time had bandy legs. They were all tiny little guys, tough little guys, like little bandy cocks, and they all wanted to hit you. And the women, it was the first time I ever seen women fighting. And they would take off their high heels and batter themselves over the head with it, which is a very serious thing to do. If you get the wrong end of a high heel, you're dead. And what do you remember about Barrowland? Here, it's in this song here, of course. But, I mean...
Well, to me, it's just a magical place. I've never had any trouble in Barrowland. And to me, what's so special about it is the way the audience get into the songs there, the way they sing along. And they have this amazing thing they do as well. If they hear a line in the song, they'll applaud a line in the song, you know, and they just have a certain way. They'll applaud for a mood, if you create a mood, and they'll applaud it without breaking it. It's hard. It's an intangible thing.
The audiences in Belfast are a little like that, and I always think there's a great similarity between the audiences in Belfast and the audience in Glasgow, because it's the same people. A lot of them are also Scots, of course. And the best story I ever heard about a Glasgow audience, and I'm sure you've heard this before, it's only a recent one, I was during a concert in Glasgow by U2, Bono. And Bono's going through a Save the World thing, you see? And he's standing on the stage and he's going, every time I clap my hand, an African child dies. And he's going... The voice comes from the audience, well, stop clapping then. I always stop clapping and save a child. There's another one here called Riding the High Stool, which I love. And it reminded me of a thing. I was talking about this the other day down in Donegal again. I had my uncles used to ride the chair when they tell you a story. Did you ever see that?
Yeah, turn it around.
They get excited. They're sitting talking to you like that, and they say, and he went over, and do you know what he said? And they jump the chair up like this,
okay,
and they pull the chair over to you. And by the time they're nearly on top of you before they have the final line, and then they have to bring the chair back again. Oh, dear. Chris, will you do something else for us? I know I'm working you too hard today.
Singing is the easiest part of what I do.
Really?
I love to sing.
And you really still do enjoy performing?
Oh, yeah, yeah. To me, when Declan and I go out and we sit down and the audience listen and the songs start, it's just, for me, it's a magical place and I love being in it, you know. The rest of it, I can take or leave, but the singing, I'll bop till I drop. Somebody mentioned this song.
Okay.
I was 18 when I came to town. They call it the summer of love. Burn them babies, burn them flags, the hawks against the dove. I took a job at the Steamin' way down on Caltrum Street, and I fell in love with a laundry girl, she was working next to me. And she was a rare thing, fine as a bee's wing, so fine a breath of wind might blow her away. And she was a lost child, she was running wild, she said, so long as there's no price on love, I'll stay. You wouldn't want me any other way. We busked around the market towns, fruit picking down in Kent. We could tinker pots and pans and knives wherever we went. We were camping down the Gower, and the work was mighty good. She wouldn't wait for the harvest, I thought we should. I said to her, we'll settle down and get a few acres dug, with a fire burning in the heart and babbies on the rug. She said, oh man, you foolish man, that surely sounds like hell. You might be lord of half the world, you'll not own me as well. Oh, she was a rare thing, fine as a bee's wing, and I miss her more than ever words could say. If I could just taste all of her wildness now, if I could hold her in my arms today, I wouldn't want her any other way.
Sometimes too many be correcting the same. Do the New York Max tops fresh and clean. The hot day max is from TK Maxx. Can I clash with me combos, but I like that. Yeah. On the daytime, on the daytime.
On the daytime.
I do me thing hard on the daytime. On the daytime, on the daytime.
On the daytime.
I do me thing hard on the daytime. On the daytime, on the daytime.
On the daytime.
I do me thing hard on the daytime. On the daytime, on the daytime.
On the daytime.
I do me thing hard. Writing tunes all day. Past 3 days, had an 8 o'clock brunch and a 1 o'clock rave. Don't need a rocket, they rock a party. Smooth like a criminal, rough but arty. Free time looking like a birthday. Don't make up rules if you don't have day. Checks looking better than a ton they start with. Really don't matter if it's Monday or Friday. Daytime on a daytime. I do me thing hard on a daytime. On a daytime, on a daytime. I do me thing hard on a daytime. On a daytime, on a daytime. She beckon, head turned ball every 5 or 6 seconds. Checks be cool when we make a move. What's up with pretending they disapprove? Shh, go on like a thief in the night. Points unforgettable, what it might be like. A new boy wants and he love to fight. Every time I see him now, he be flying a kite.
Daytime on a daytime.
I do me thing hard on a daytime. On a daytime, on a daytime. I do me thing hard on a daytime. On a daytime, on a daytime.
On a
do me thing hard on a daytime. On a daytime.
That, you know who that is? That's Wild Man.
Yes.
That's a Derry rapper. And only in Derry can the words don't have to rhyme with Friday. Don't Half Day, Friday. Eh? That's a song called In the Daytime. It's from his new album, which is called Antidote. Now, do you know the thing I found about really talented people, singers, songwriters? What's the thing that they all have in common? You know, and it's a very unusual thing, and it would not immediately come to mind. What's the thing that they all have in common?
Long fingernails.
No, I wasn't thinking in terms of that. I was thinking in terms of personality. I was thinking in terms of what they all have in common is that they're all very prepossessing and they're not shouting about what they do. And they don't really tell you an awful lot about what they do. And they're generally nice people. Those are the really, really talented ones. Now, the ones who aren't so talented, they're sometimes not nice at all. And sometimes they keep talking about themselves. So you always know when you're talking to somebody who's really, really talented, even if they display it or not, by the way they talk to you. I know by talking to somebody if they're talented or not. The other way you know by talking to me if I'm talented or not.
Yes.
And I don't know the way. No, we won't.
No.
We won't bother with that. Hmm. So one of the people I enjoyed most of all, apart from Christy, we're talking to, was a lady from America called Beth Nielsen Chapman. You've met her, haven't you?
Did she live in Donegal?
No, she did not live in Donegal.
But who was the girl that lived in Donegal used to listen to you?
That was, let me think who
that
was.
Do you remember that?
I know, it'll come to me in a moment.
Listened to you all the time.
Listened all the time.
Big fan of the
program. She loved this program, and her name was, and I don't remember what it is, and that's a terribly sad thing.
Was it Mary?
Mary, no. No.
It wasn't Mary?
No, Mary. No.
Mary Chapin.
Mary Chapin Carpenter.
I was trying to.
Mary Chapin
Carpenter.
You know, Carpenter.
I was trying to, you know.
No, you tried to feed me there.
Yes, I did,
but
yes.
But you did
yes.
not realise that I genuinely forgot her name.
See these live programmes?
They're terrible.
You see, if this had been recorded, we could have cut that out and you would have got it immediately.
I know. But see, people won't hear it because it will have been already cut out.
Right.
That was Mary Chapin Carpenter. Used to listen to this programme. She used to live up in Donegal getting herself together in the country. And she discovered this programme. She could have listened to The Fat Boy. She could have listened to Hugo. She could have listened to Downtown City Beat. But no! She could have listened to Highland Radio.
She lived up there and nobody bothered about
nobody
her.
Nobody bothered about her because nobody knew who she was. Donegal is like that. You can go up there and live in Donegal. Sarah Jessica Parker. Your woman, Sex and the City, lives up there and nobody bothers about her. And she goes, she shears sheep and everything.
Do you remember?
And her husband, Matthew Broderick, is down at the pub and has a pint. Nobody bothers about him.
Do you remember
people,
the time?
I mean, people go into the pub and ask where they live. They won't tell them. Because I often tried it. I said, where do them people live? And they say, we're not telling you.
Do you remember the time we went looking for Doris Day?
Yes, and we nearly knocked on her door and then finally,
no, we sat outside a store.
I know.
And you said to me, she keeps a lot of cats. So there's a possibility she could be buying cat food today. And we imagined Doris Day to come walking along with a straw basket and a gingham cloth over it and to go into the store and buy cat food. And then we would say, hello, Doris. And we sat for an hour or so outside the store.
Yeah, that was when I went through my Inspector Clouseau period. Anyway, never mind Doris Day. We don't want to talk about Doris Day. We want to talk about Beth Nielsen Chapman. You'll notice at the beginning of this interview that I am not actually in my proper position. Nothing in there. I'm sorry about that. Can the people hear me? Sorry, I was under the table. Beth Nielsen Chapman, good morning. Sorry
good
for the
morning.
Mix-up. Look at you, how lovely you are.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. It's great
the
to be
back. The last time I saw you, you were with Kimmy Rhodes, wasn't it?
I was. In fact, I just saw her.
And do you know what you were like? You were like two schoolgirls on their holidays. And you're running around mad.
I got myself another little schoolgirl.
Indeed, yes, with Eilie Patterson.
That's right.
Because you and Eilie go back. Eilie, how are you?
I discovered her. Did you know?
You did. Eilie, tell me about you and this woman here.
Well, we just got back from Scotland. We were over at Celtic Connections doing a gig over there at the Glasgow Royal Concert Hall. So that was a great experience. Uh-huh. Really
good. Oh, she was awesome. I've roped her into doing background vocals for me on a couple of my shows.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And who's this gentleman with you?
This is Martin Alcock. The legendary Mart Alcock.
I'm trying to figure out where I met Mart before. We have met before.
I think it was 100 years ago when I was playing with Fairport Convention.
That's right. I was only a boy broadcast.
Yeah, that's it.
But so where do we start with you? I mean, you've written so many great songs, and everybody in the world has recorded your songs, and you're just so wonderful.
Oh,
I think that's a good place
to start.
You're absolutely right.
Let's start there and go straight from there onward.
And your new album, which I forgot to bring in with me, I had it inside.
James, we'll need that new album.
New album, bring that.
It's called Back to Love.
I was in such a hurry. I was under the table. But that's been Radio 2's album of the week.
I know. I'm so excited about that. It's been incredible. The response has been fantastic. And you know, right in the middle of making that record, I found out I had a brain tumor and I had a craniotomy and all
what?
This stuff happened to me. Yeah, it was. Like, hello, you know, so actually getting through that and everything's fine and they got it all out and it was benign and I lived. But finishing the record after all that was particularly a sweet experience. You know, it was really...
You had such terrible luck. I mean, you had. I mean,
and good luck too. No, but, I mean, I lived, Jerry. I did live.
I know. You had a bout with breast cancer.
Yeah, yeah. Well, actually, 2010 is definitely my year. I mean, it started off with the single doing great at Radio 2, and you know, it's my 10-year anniversary of surviving breast cancer, and sometime before the end of the year, I'm getting married. So. All of these loose ends are getting tied up. It's you know,
congratulations,
it's a good year. It's a good year. Oh no, he's married.
He's
extremely married.
Well, I have to say, you look great.
Oh, thanks.
You look great.
I feel great, and I'm really so happy to be back in Belfast. You know, there's just something about this town.
There is, actually.
And playing in the Grand Opera House on Wednesday. Yeah,
Wednesday the 3rd of February.
Yeah, and that's an amazing venue.
You were there before, remember, with Rodney Crowell?
Yep, Rodney and Kimmy Rhodes and Karen
I was at
Goss.
That one of those nights. It was great.
It was incredible. It was so wonderful to be up there with those artists. And I remember just thinking, gosh, I want them all to go away so I can sing all the songs in this venue. Because this venue was just, you know... Beautiful.
Well, it's a Victorian music hall.
Yeah, it's so fabulous. But now I miss them. Now I wish they'd come back.
Okay, so Eileen, are you gonna sing a wee bit with Beth?
Yes, yeah. I'm gonna sing some background vocals.
All right, Beth, would you like to do?
Yeah, we're gonna do a song.
I'm sorry, we should have been on here half an hour ago.
Oh well, you know.
Make the best of it in the next 15 or 20 minutes.
Well, this is a song from the record. It actually opens the record. It's a song I wrote with Daryl Scott, and it's one of the first songs I wrote on the bouzouki, which is what this little thing is. And it goes like this.
Last a lifetime.
That's great. The two of you sound really good together. And Ailey's on the record.
She is. She's actually singing that on the record.
Yeah, and that's called Hallelujah. And this is from your new album,
yeah,
which is called Back to Love. What great artwork. You look great in
those
great photographs. Thank you. And you're also appearing live on Terry Wogan's new show.
Yes, I'm very excited about that. And I'm so happy to see Terry again. And
yeah, he's been good to you,
actually. I guess everybody's in post-Terry mourning because everybody's going to miss him so much. But
he liked your music.
He was wonderful.
He did.
Paul Walters and Terry Wogan were really, really super sweet.
He doesn't like Eileen Patterson's music.
Oh, well, he hasn't had me talk to him about her.
I sent him her last album, and I said, Terry, please play this. And he never bought his arse, Eileen.
I know, can you
tell him
it?
That?
You know, he's just so inundated. He probably sits in a big pile of albums all the time. But, you know, I'll put in a word, don't you worry, my
darling. I suspect
darling.
He doesn't listen to them at all. It's the producer does it. He sits there and smokes his cigars and does whatever he wants.
And we don't have a radio station like that anymore. We don't have radio stations with actual people sitting inside, which you can call and say, play that again. You know, it's really changed.
And you're right, actually, because, you know, at the risk of being sycophantic, BBC is great because, I mean, you can play whatever you like. No, you really can.
Right.
You know how rare that is these days.
Yeah.
I mean, I can go in there and nobody says to me, listen, play this. Nobody does that. I can play whatever I like.
Right.
And it's really horrible, the stuff that I play usually, you know.
No.
But it's my horrible stuff.
I resemble that remark.
But, you know, the point is you're allowed to be yourself. You know, you can play whatever you want. And you know those days are gone in America. It's all playlists, isn't it? Everybody's working away.
But then
you repay us by taking her out of the BBC.
Well, that's what you get.
You're poaching employees, making them want to go away and be singers.
She's the perfect roadie, too. She hands me my guitar. She's so fabulous. No, she's brilliant. And I think of Eileen as somebody to watch. You know, I mean, I've told a lot of people. She's come to Nashville several times.
Yeah,
And I've put the word out, you know, you want to get to write a song with this one here because she's going to be taking the world by storm, I think.
I think so. And she's already agreed to pay me 10% of any money she earns.
Yes.
Until she's 40.
And I'm keeping all of her publishing. No.
And you keep the publishing, I'll get 10%, and then she can keep the rest. There's a kind of a long tradition going back a number of years, but it started in the kind of country and western field. There used to be quite a good number of country and western singers who used to play on what they used to call show bands here.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever they went to Nashville, they impressed because, I don't know why, there was something about them, you know, and I think maybe that kind of thing is kind of going on just a wee bit, you know. You know, this gentleman, Martin, is it? Martin, a lot of English guys don't seem to make an impact there.
In Nashville?
Yeah, don't seem to.
There's been one or two. Winwood.
Steve Winwood did it, yeah.
Well, he came from kind of pop and rock in a way, you know. But, I mean, people just going over there, they don't see... I don't know of any English person who's kind of...
And the gentleman who married Emmylou Harris, whose name has just flown right out of my head, who I know very well.
There was Clive... Gregson as well.
Yeah.
But I'm sure there are. But there's something about it. I think it's something to do with the music because, I mean, country music is basically Irish music that went over and came back again and just went back and forth.
Well, I think there's a huge, huge connection between Irish music and country and Appalachian. I mean, I think we basically...
It's Irish
soul. Stole it. And, you know.
Irish soul. You don't have that, Mark.
There was that really good TV series, Bringing It All Back Home.
That's right.
About the music going over there and coming
That's
back
right.
here again.
Look at the time. We started late. You should have been on here 10 past 11. But through no fault of your own, we didn't get started until about 25. We've only got time for one more.
All right.
Will you do one for us?
We'll do another song that Eileen's singing on the record of.
Okay.
Of on the record too. Or whatever that would be in English.
That was nearly English. Beth Neilson Chapman, Mart, Eileen, thank you very much for coming in. And sorry for messing you all about.
Oh no. It's
These people are
fabulous.
Amateurs.
This one's called Shadows.
Fine, everything remember in its own time. Every wave surrenders at the shoreline. Time peels back the sky and the clouds hurl shadows at the wind. Oh, yes, pay no mind to me, it's only hopeless. By a small degree, let's watch the sunset slide into the sea, while the clouds hurl shadows at the wind. And love is bright. I don't know these steps, and there's a spot.
On 92 to 95 FM
and 1341 medium wave,
this is BBC Radio Ulster.
And at 11 o'clock, this is the BBC News with Keith Burnside. Residents of a housing estate in Lurgan say several houses there have been flooded. John Mitchell, who lives in the Shankill estate, says a row of seven houses has been affected.
The sewers and everything came up through and run the whole way through all the houses and flooded every one of the houses in the row. And the whole lot of them, the water run from the back doors right through the front doors and everything in the living rooms and bedrooms and all is destroyed.
Shops are predicting they will sell less in 2011. The British Retail Consortium says almost two-thirds of its members expect sales to fall because of weak demand, inflation and the rise in VAT on January the 4th. Retailers are hoping this week will make up for lost business before Christmas. They're hoping the thaw will bring out shoppers to the sales. Paul McMahon, General Manager of Castle Court in Belfast, says there were queues before stores opened this morning.
Well, I think today is very important for retailers. It hasn't been a great Christmas, obviously hampered by the weather, and there's a lot of expectations on today and really for this week in terms of making up some of that lost ground. And a lot of retailers are expecting to be very busy for the whole week. But, you know, the signs are positive. The thaw has really helped. The roads are clear. And there have been queues at some of the stores, and we expect that to continue.
Nine men are due to appear in court accused of plotting a terrorist bombing campaign in Britain. The suspects, aged between 19 and 28, are from Cardiff, London and Stoke-on-Trent. They were arrested in raids last week. They're charged with conspiring to cause explosions and preparing for terrorist acts. Officials in Iraq say bombers have attacked a government compound in the town of Ramadi, west of Baghdad. It's thought at least 17 people have been killed and more than 40 wounded. Air, rail and road transport has been thrown into chaos by blizzard conditions along the United States' eastern coast. New York's main airport, JFK, was closed. Rail services were suspended between New York and Boston. Sport and today's Carling Premiership game between Dungannon and Newry has been postponed, but the Mid-Ulster derby between Portadown and Glenavon will go ahead. Cliftonville's home game with Crusaders is on, although there will be a precautionary pitch inspection at midday, while Ulster's Magners League rugby game against Leinster is also on. The road service says the M2 onslip at Temple Patrick, which is Junction 5, is now open. It had been closed because of ice. And a weather update, cloudy and mild with occasional light rain, which will become more persistent and heavy this afternoon and into this evening. Temperatures will get up to around 7 degrees Celsius. Further showers are forecast tonight and some will again be heavy, but then drier with temperatures falling no lower than 3 degrees. BBC News.
OK, welcome back to this special programme on Monday the 27th of December, during the course of which we are... Are we here?
We're nearly here.
We are here. We certainly are here. Going to play a record now because it's important that people play the records to know that we're here. Okay? Mm-hmm. You got that?
Yes.
That's it?
If you didn't play music, they would never know we were here.
You think there's nobody here because who would put on the record and press the button?
Stand alive, yes, you're right. next to nothing. The next to bystanders who should have said something. It was not in my vision, it was not in my mind to return from a mission a man left behind. Yeah. Here's one to go.
That's Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. That's a song called Running Man's Bible. I think that's the first time I ever played it in its entirety. It's a wee bit long, but it's worth it, isn't it? That's from an album called Mojo. What's the question you don't like to be? What's the question you don't like to be asked?
What agey?
No. We've been over that. We've lied already. The question you don't like to be asked: God, name me all the best musical talent in Derry. You don't like to be asked that because all the musical talent comes out of Derry. Go on, name them. And then you go, Dana. And you go, Phil Coulter. And then you go, Undertones. Who else? And then you're stuck, aren't you?
Right.
You're stuck after that.
Well.
Because people think that Joseph Locke, you say.
Mm-hmm.
And then you keep going. But you keep getting stuck. But there's one new name, Maeve McGinley. Maeve McGinley is the youngest person I think we ever had on this programme playing music and playing her own music and playing the piano and wonderful classical pianist. You met her, didn't you?
I discovered her.
You did not. That's
I
a
did.
Lie. That's
I did.
A dirty lie.
I did.
A dirty lie.
It is not. I discovered her.
You did not discover her.
No.
She's been playing since she was five.
It doesn't matter. Her parents brought her music to me. And ask me what I played.
Ask her, would you turn it over for her?
No.
ask her, would you play it?
And I was asked to come and compare one of her shows.
All right, then. You
well, you didn't
her.
Discover
her. Maeve McGinley's a... Can you just give me just a wee bit of credit? Just once in your life.
I'll tell you how I can prove it.
All right, then.
Her mother and father bought me a tie.
Okay.
And I have the tie in my desk.
That's proof indeed. And they signed it and they said, this tie is to commemorate the discovery of my daughter by Sean Coyle. They signed it and they dated it and everything. And Notary Public stamped
it. No, they wanted me to play and said, right, could you help her along?
Is that the people to be the judge? This young lady, what age is she, 15? 16? Something like that?
Mm-hmm. Incredibly. Is that now?
Wonderful classical pianist, has gone off to Venice, everywhere. And all these people think she's wonderful. And she's
You never heard her.
I think you'll find that I'm interviewing her here.
Have you never heard her before you interviewed her?
No.
No? Oh, you see, I had been to her concerts.
You must have got in for nothing.
I was compare.
Will you keep quiet and stop crowing? You're getting like Nolan. I'll just say, quiet now, please. Pray silence, Maeve McGinley.
Hello.
Well, you know, I'm just looking at all the stuff here, the stuff that you've done, and what, you're 15?
Yep.
50. Well, when did you start playing the piano?
Whenever I was 7.
Well, was there a tradition in your family, a musical tradition?
Not really. Just my great uncle Eugene was a famous violinist, traditional player. And, you know, I always loved listening to music, but there was never really any traditions for any great pianists or singers or, you know, real musicians.
Did you have a piano at home?
No, I never had a piano at home until I started playing it. I started practicing on a tiny, tiny keyboard, and then Mommy bought me a piano.
And then that was your way.
Yep.
And, I mean, it's amazing. I'm just reading some of this stuff about you. It's just amazing what you've done. I'm just looking at this here. You played Mozart's clavier in the Hofburg Palace in Vienna in a closed visit after winning the International Composers Competition when you were 12 years old.
Yes.
You were the first child composer to perform in a royal court, in the Royal Court, Palace of Westminster, since Mozart.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I can just go on and on, but it's silly just reading all this stuff because it's just one amazing thing, one after another. And you also want to be, have you done any conducting?
No, I haven't done any conducting, but ideally I think it would be really interesting. Because as a composer, I think that it would be great for me to have the experience to conduct an orchestra so I can tell them exactly how the music is supposed to be played. You know what I mean? Because it's my music.
I know. I'm just looking at you, and you should be running after Jedward.
No.
Do you know what I mean? Because I was over in a hotel last night, and Jedward was staying there, and a lot of girls, just like you, were all running around, and I'm saying, and I looked at you today, and I said, they're over after Jedward, and you're composing and conducting with Vienna and everything.
I'm running anyway, after my
well,
dream.
Fair play to you. But you do actually, you compose some music yourself.
Yes, I do.
Are you going to do a wee piece for us now? Tell us what it is.
I'll play a piece that I composed the main theme of it whenever I was 7 years old, and it was just messing around one day, basically, and then a couple of months ago I started developing on what I already had, and it just turned into something. I like it.
Okay, off you go.
Thank you.
Maeve's going to have to wheel around a wee bit, and she's just getting herself organised. The microphone is over here. There you go. Thank you.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. I don't think I've ever heard anything quite like that, to be honest with you. I've never heard anything like that. It's so different. And that's your own composition.
Yeah.
And what do you call it?
God Has Risen.
God Has Risen.
Yep.
I'm surprised Phil Coulter hasn't had you put down years ago. Have you ever talked to Phil? I mean, this is a whole Derry thing, I know, but, you know, Phil's a great champion of young musicians.
Yeah.
Have you ever met him?
No, I've never met him.
Really?
Yeah, never met him.
Never met him?
No.
I think he'd want to meet you. He's probably afraid of you. Now, composition is... What's the biggest part of your life? Is it the composing? Is it the playing? Or what is it?
I think it's... To be honest, it's just everything all around the music. I don't have a particular favourite or something that's most important to me, but, you know, ideally I think it would be, I want to get into the entertainment industry, do you know what I mean, with my music. And I suppose it's every artist's dream to secure a recording contract, but
right.
Whatever way you go about doing that, I don't know, but it's, for me, it's been able to share with other people the music, do you know what I mean, and connect with them through music, because it's like a universal language as well, so you can speak to anybody through music. So,
and you particularly like pop music when you're 15 years old, of course you are. And you like pop music and you sing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of an unusual thing. You're able to do that, and then you're able to do Run by Snow Patrol, or you're able to do all kinds of stuff. And I mean, do you think, are you going to spread yourself thin? Are you going to try and do everything?
I'm not going to try and do everything. I'm going to do everything.
You're going to do everything? All right, then.
Hopefully.
Okay. Do you want to do something else now?
Whatever I'll you like. Sing a song.
Okay, what is it?
Knocking on Heaven's Door.
Knocking on Heaven's Door, Bob Dylan. That's all right. From Chopin to Bob Dylan. Oh, are you okay?
Yeah.
You just caught your wee thing there. That's all right. That's Maeve McGinley on vocals and playing piano. Bob Dylan's Knocking on Heaven's Door. Would you ever try and write a song like that? I mean, do you write pop songs? You couldn't call that a pop song, I suppose, really. But would you try and write a contemporary song?
I'd give it a go, so I would. I think it would be something would be different to do.
Have you not tried that yet?
I've tried, yes. So I have written some songs, but I like doing putting music to words.
Yes.
I've done that with one of W.B. Yeats's poems, so I did.
Which one was that?
It's called The Fierce Horsemen.
Oh.
I put music to his words.
Uh-huh. Now, there's another girl, she's a very prominent pianist, classical pianist from Derry, and her name is Ruth McGinley. You're no relative of hers.
Not at all.
Isn't that amazing?
It's crazy. Everybody always asks, are you anything to Ruth?
Yeah. Ruth is a fine pianist. I mean, yep. It's just amazing. I mean, when you consider the two people like yourselves, two young girls like that, people talk about Derry and about, you know, the kind of musical heritage mm-hmm. that it has. Does that mean anything to you? Did you ever get involved in the Derry Fete or anything like that?
I competed in the Derry Fete every year until I was about 11.
Well, people talk about that, you know, because I personally, and it's probably a strange thing to say, and people don't like me saying it, people say that people from Derry have got a peculiar talent for music. I don't think that. I think it's because they're caught very early. Do you know what I mean? I mean, you were caught when you were like 7, you know?
Yeah.
And other places, you know, people, they play, but they don't get the encouragement that they get in Derry because of the fish. And even that's under threat now at the moment, I think, because of financial problems. But, you know, it's always on at this time of year, Easter, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not a great musical genius, Benny Beans, but I started off in the fish and I was singing and I wasn't dancing, I was in choirs and stuff like that. But you got used to learning stuff and being able to perform in public. You know, you were doing it. So when was the first time you were on Derry Fish?
When I was 8.
You see?
But I danced in it when I was younger. But then, again, whenever I was over in Vienna, you know, it's crazy. There's these people and they can't even read yet and they're learning how to play piano. Do you know, like, one Japanese students from over there, it was like, what age did you start playing at? And they were 2. In the classical field, it's like, if you start at 7, you might as well give up when you're my age because you've no chance. And, you know, in the classical field of music, like, to them, they were shocked, but...
They were shocked when you found out
you
were as old as 7 when you started?
Yeah, and they think this is crazy, this is absurd. You can't start playing piano when you're 7. And they were like, oh, I started playing when I was 2.
2.
I didn't even... Shocking.
People changing their nappy on the piano stool, you know? you mentioned you go to Vienna. Tell me about, what's the Vienna thing? What's that all about? Do you still study there?
I go over every few months, so I do. I would stay in contact with the professors and they would give me tips and all over the internet, but then every few months I'll travel over to see them. And
what do you do when you go there?
Masterclasses with the professors.
Just for the benefit of people who don't know, what is a masterclass?
It's like a workshop nearly, do you know what I mean? It's like a piano lesson, only maybe, like, I had one that lasted 4 hours, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Take a 10-minute break, and it's just really intense, and it's not with just a piano teacher who has maybe only got their grade 8, it's with professors that have their degree in music and know, you know what I mean, they're amazing, basically.
Is it a one-on-one thing, or are there students there? Is it just you?
No, it's one-on-one. So
just you and the professor?
Yeah.
Well, they must think you're not bad. Do you want to do something else for us?
Yeah, okay.
What do you want to do? Whatever you like.
Dear Mr. President.
What is that?
It's a song by Pink.
Go ahead. Pink and Chopin.
Mr. President, come take a walk with me. And let's pretend we're just two people and you're no better than me. I'd like to ask you some questions if we can speak honestly.
street. Who do you pray for a nap before you go to sleep? What do you feel when you look in the mirror? Are you proud? How do you sleep while the rest of us cry? How do you dream when a mother has no chance to say goodbye? How do you walk with your head held high? Can you even look me in the eye and tell me why? Dear Mr. President, were you a lonely boy? How can you say no child is left behind? Oh, we're not dumb, oh, we're not blind. They're all sitting in your cells while you pay the road to hell. What kind of father might take his own daughter's rights away? What kind of father might hate his own daughter if she were gay? I can only imagine what the First Lady has to say. You've come a long way from whiskey and cocaine. Dream when a mother has no chance to say goodbye. How do you walk with your head held high? Can you even look me in the eye? Let me tell you about hard work, minimum wage with a baby on the way. Let me tell you about hard work, rebuilding your house after the bomb. Let me tell you about hard work, building a bed out of a cardboard box. Let me tell you about hard work, hard work, hard work. You don't know nothing about hard work, hard work, hard work. How do you sleep President, you'd never take a walk with me. Oh, would you?
I'm feeling someone watching me, and so I raise my head.
does not really see me, cause she sees her own reflection. And I'm trying not to notice that she's hitching up her skirt. And while she's straightening her stockings, her hair has gotten wet. The morning as I'm listening to the bells of the cathedral. I am thinking of your voice.
Suzanne Vega, that's a song called Tom's Down, a special version of that. What we're trying to do today, as you well know, is now there's two things we could have done. We could have played a lot of small, little, short clips of a lot of people, or play extended clips of people, you know. So I thought it'd be easier to do that because it means you and I wouldn't have to talk so much.
See, I thought about, do you remember a couple of days ago, last week, I mentioned to you that I wanted to be a TV chat show host?
Yes, it was a rush of blood to the head.
And I wanted you to be a co-presenter.
Yes.
And what I wanted was that you would introduce your people, for instance, your music. You would introduce the likes of Maeve McGinley. You would introduce the likes of Beth Nathan Chapman. And I would say, ladies and gentlemen, here's Charlie Lansbury. And then you would say, ladies and gentlemen, here's Christy Moore. And I would say, here's Charlie Lansbury again. You know, And we would bring them on and we would chat to them, you see, and talk to the people, and then everybody would think it's a great show.
You would talk to Charlie and I'd talk to the rest of them.
Yes.
Many times you talk to Charlie three or four times.
Oh, absolutely.
Introduce him three or four
every
times.
Every show. Bring him on every show.
Okay, well, there's an idea. I think we should hoist it up the flagpole, see if it flutters. I think it would probably hang limply.
I could bring Daniel on.
Yes, and see how young he gets. Look at all the people we had on. Let me just name some of the people. The Reparees, Rory Fayfield, Phil Davidson, both from Australia. Kimmy Rhodes, America, Andy White from Australia and Belfast. Aaron Shanley, Paul Shevlin, Sheelan, Janet Dowd, The Farriers, Southern, Cashier No. 9, Kitty and the Canovers, Carl Verheyen, one of the best guitar players in the world. And the greatest, for my money, up there was Christy Moore, Andy Devine. Eh? Remember him? And a young lady called Kate McCusker. I liked her particularly. Here's her little record. I like this one. There was something about her that I really liked. She had a certain charm, you know, that we lack.
See, I never met her.
She had nice kind of, you know, she was a nice person. You know the way we're not nice people. And you recognise it when you see it.
Where's she from?
Oma. Kate McCusker. What a great sound this is as well. It's called The Way, since you ask.
Thank you.
That's Kate McCusker for a moment. That's a song called The Way. And our next wadge of music is coming from Kevin Doherty, another great talent and a man not too far away from here, almost from Derry, actually. He's from Buncrana, County Donegal. And he's very, very unusual in that there's nobody like him at all.
Another one of my discoveries.
Yes. How did you discover him?
Playing golf with him.
And what did he say?
He was a very, very good golfer. No,
so I believe.
Well, he was in. He was the assistant.
He was also in Four Men and a Dog. Maybe that had something to do with the fact that he was playing golf as well.
Yeah, but he was an assistant pro at the golf club I was at. His father was the professional. He was there helping out, and we used to play golf together.
Uh-huh.
And he played guitar and sang. And I says, "You're very good. Why didn't you come along and let Gerry Anderson hear you?"
I don't think that's true.
No, he said to me, he gave me some little tapes and recordings. He said, "Would you bring those to Gerry and let Gerry hear them?"
I think you're making that up.
That's the truth. You can ask him. I kid you not.
All right, then. He's got a new album out now at the moment. Well, he had an album out earlier on during the year, which is very well received by critics and punters alike.
It was very tall. Telegram.
He's very tall.
Very tall.
And the thing that's annoying about it, very good looking.
Yeah, that's
I can't handle that.
No, I don't.
You're standing there, you know.
We've always wanted to be tall.
I know, but you're standing there. I don't mind people who are tall, but you can deal with that if they're ugly.
Yes.
But you're standing beside him and he's tall and he's good looking, you know, and I just don't like it.
No.
Because people come along and they look at him, they don't look at me.
And he dresses well.
I'd be telling him to sit down, you know. Sit down there.
It's a pity, isn't it?
It's a pity. He dresses well and he's talented and good looking and tall. I hate these people. He's full head of hair and everything.
Yes.
I can't be bothered with that. Anyway, I managed to disguise my anger with him when he was in the studio. So please. He's got a new stage show at the moment, which is very innovative, apparently. It's called Telegraph after his last album. And he's touring the country with that. Intermittently, he's not doing a lot of gigs, but every once in a while he appears. He uses all kinds of different things. So maybe perhaps they would like to go along and see that, the punters who are listening.
I was at his wedding.
Yes, that's great. Yes.
You weren't at that. You weren't invited.
I wasn't at that, no. Anyway.
Brendan Quinn was at it.
Well, that's even better. This is Kevin Doherty, who's now married. Let's start at the beginning. You and I have a lot in common. The only thing we don't have in common is that I have no talent. But you're from a small town in a show called Buncrana. Right. Now, I regard myself as from there, really, because my mother was born just a couple of miles outside in a place called Shandon.
I know it.
Just
know it.
Past Cockhill Chapel. These people in Enniskillen know what we're talking about. So, you grew up in that, and I know how musical those people are. And you know, what kind of a childhood did you have? You're surrounded by music, I imagine.
Well, it was, but not in the conventional. You know, well, I started playing in traditional music, and you'd be talking to people, and they, you know, fiddles from four, and accordions, and banjos, and but it wasn't like that. But the house was filled. There was always music. Everybody, there was music everywhere, and I knew my father. I mean. One clear memory I have it would be wet Sundays at the City of Derry when there was nobody there and the rain would be whacking off the window. And Benny Green, he had a programme on BBC Two on a Sunday afternoon.
I remember Benny Green.
I remember that programme. So that was Peggy Lee and Lena Horne and that stuff. That, my father was a great admirer of what he said, people who could sing. So I must be a great disappointment to him.
Proud of you then.
Yeah.
But you would be, you wrote a song one time called Jimmy Gallagher's Saxophone. I mentioned it before we just came in there. And that was about a man that you and I would have known. It was a wonderful saxophone player. And they called him Pope Gallagher.
Pope Gallagher.
And he was very much ahead of his time, wasn't he?
Well, you see, it was in hindsight that I learned all that because he was my next door neighbour.
Yeah.
So I played with his kids were next door. So yeah. I found him a remarkable presence. As when you are kids, you don't make great leaps and connections. You're just impressed with certain people, and they make an impact on your day to day life. And he was one that certainly resonated in a way that came back to me later. And suddenly he loomed quite large for a time, just as a figure of great romance.
We're talking about people that other people don't know. I mean, another man who had an influence on you, I know, was a man who used to live next door to me down there. Was Denny McLaughlin, the traditional musician.
Well, Denny, an influence maybe put. Well, he was a great facilitator in that he, not just me, but a lot of people, he invited people that weren't part of the setup, part of the session, part of the fraternity or musical community. He invited newcomers, greenhorns in, even though, I mean, when I started playing with these well-established musicians, I was raw as possibly could be. But he obviously saw that there was some musical talent, and then he encouraged that. And that's what he... I think that was one of his great... or is one of his great gifts, is an ability to draw music out of people, which is a gift.
I remember him when he had hair.
Oh, well, now that's...
a long time ago.
Now, that's... my imagination doesn't leap that far.
No, but that inclusivity, I mean, that, those people down there are just wonderful people. Maybe we could talk to you all day, and I think we're getting... I don't know you all that well, but I know your background so well, so I'm getting involved in all this, so I better not talk about that. I'll talk about something else later. But do a wee song for us first. What's your favourite song on it that you can do here?
I can do any of them here.
Okay. I thought maybe sometimes you would need something else.
No, I'll do... There's one that I kind of like. You need love and money to get by. Love and money to get by. Let me tell you plain, my pretty, there ain't no Emerald City, but you know Emerald City was a lie. You need love and money to get by. Let's take C6 Steve as an example. That's fair. There was a time when he could only get arrested. Now he's viewed as a capital investment. He used to hang around street corners. Now he's sipping wine at Warner's, saying, here's some corporate mud in your eye. He knows you need love and you need money to get by. Let's take the Beatles up into the present day. Let's hear all the lovely Beatly things they say. They say love is all you need to Mr. Paxman. Then they castigate the taxman. They know that stuff doesn't fall from the sky. No, you need love and you need money to get by. You can say that it doesn't matter, that the former always overcomes the latter. Well, I'm not changing my religion, but once you bring the kids into it, to keep them healthy, happy and wise, you need love and money to get by. You need love and you need money to get by. Let me tell you plain, my pretty, there ain't no Emerald City, but you know Emerald City was a lie. You need love and you need money to get by.
That's a good song. I like that.
Thank you.
C6 Steve, I started out with nothing and I still got most of it left.
Yeah, no,
the best title track ever. People want you to play Tugboat, want you to play Camden Street. Camden Street, of course, that's a good song.
Oh.
You live there now. You live in Dublin, don't you?
I live around the corner from Camden Street. I live in Portobello. Great part of town.
I used to live there too.
Been there for 15 years this mm-hmm. time, this mm-hmm. trip. So it's very much its home. Ironically, though, I mean, the song talks about never being happier than walking on Camden Street. And about 5 weeks ago, I was walking on Camden Street and fell down and broke my elbow.
Oh, lovely.
Lovely, yeah.
That's because you recorded the song, you see, Tempted Fate.
I shouldn't have done that.
No, you still, Four Men and a Dog are still going, aren't they? But you do your own thing every now and again, but you're still an entity, aren't you?
Four Men and a Dog is very, very important to me. It's a special situation. I'd say outside the family, it's probably where I'm happiest, in a kind of a way, because we're a band.
You tour a lot. You tour all over the world, don't you?
All over the world, yeah. I remember, funny, you've played a lot. You played in groups. I don't know if you played in many bands, if you know the...
Yeah.
And I remember Levon, actually, we mentioned him before, but I remember in his convertible driving around Woodstock one day, and he says, you know, that you've got something that a lot of people don't have. I said, what's that? It wasn't money, you know what I mean? He says, you're a band.
Yeah.
He says, you're a real band. And he says, I know the difference.
Uh-huh.
I figured, and it's true. And it's a kind of a foxhole mentality in a way. You know, you look out for each other and
And you like each other.
Absolutely.
It's very unusual to be in a band that people, that's what he meant. It's very unusual to be in a band for any number of years because you usually hate somebody.
Well, this is it. Well, we got rid of them.
He went, did he?
No. And there's a great mutual kind of respect involved too, which is vital. Distance.
Mm-hmm. Because you're spending 24 hours a day with these people.
Yeah.
You know, and if you don't like each other, it really grows and grows and becomes a horrible, horrible thing, and you end up hitting people.
And then you get on stage, and again, with Four Men and Dogs, I mean, it is. Some nights it can be absolutely electric.
And Gino's losing weight. Huh?
He is probably one of my great people in the whole world, and I'm not hearing a word said about one of the country's finest.
That's Gino Lipari. A large man.
He's a wonderful man.
I see you've a notion of playing the piano here.
I'm going to sing a song for Gino. No, do you know what? I when Michael Bradley was talking to me about it, and he says, yes. "What?" I assume it's a guitar, and I said, "Well, you assume correctly, but the piano, I can't play it, but that never stopped me in anything else." And I just love the sound of a piano sort of wafting up around your lugs.
Okay. What are you going to do? Do you think?
Well, I'll sing a song off the record, and it's a song called When I Dream.
Right.
And this is for all the married people out there.
All right. Long may they flourish.
Exactly.
Kevin Doherty.
A devotional kind of love that can survive gas bills and such things. Everybody's are, but it's not them that I'm thinking of when I wish upon this star. And it's not this bloody world with all its hunger and its greed. It's you, it's always you. And I know these things I dream, I seldom say them, but there's times when words will not do. When I dream, you know I dream of you. First,
you play that piano well enough to get by. Is that the first time you ever played piano live in the radio?
Live anywhere outside my back room. So there you go.
She squinted into the light, though
those western rays were far too bright, burning on her skin. Rubbed the sleep out of her eyes and turned her back on darker skies. Said it's time to let her in. I can see you. With sunburned feet drawn by a distant beak to the solitary shore of glistening sands, broken shells, 100,000 fare-thee-wells, something new she could not ignore. I can see you.
Rory Fairfield, Big Blue Western Skies. We may not get to the end of this, so it's goodbye from me. Back tomorrow at the same time. Not the same time, 10:30.
She squinted into the light. The western rays were far too bright on that solitary shore of glistening sands, broken shells, 100,000 fare-thee-wells, something new she could not ignore, something new she could not ignore. I can see
gently. We went to bed. It was a bit snowy. We wakened up this morning. It is a winter wonderland. It really is.
With Kim Lenehan and This New Day.
Oh, the weather outside is frightful.
So what I suggest is if you don't have to go anywhere, that you snuggle down. Keep yourself warm and enjoy some lovely music on This New Day with me, Kim Lenehan.
Sunday mornings from 7 on BBC Radio Ulster, and listen again anytime at bbc.co.uk/radioulster.
Let it snow, let it snow.